Well, as we've been talking about all morning across Canada this weekend, the news of the Humboldt bus crash has hit the heart of this country. We're holding our own children in a little closer, and the sense of sadness is palpable. For many people, the questions are at the top of our minds. How can the families, the teammates, and the community move forward after such a staggering loss? For more, we're joined by Karen Letofsky, a grief and crisis counselor and executive vice president of Crisis Services Canada. Karen, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
What is the first thing grief counselors like yourself do when a tragedy like this hits?
I think it's that we recognize that needs change over time, and that when a tragedy first occurs, people are in a state of shock, are reacting to the trauma, the unpredictability, the violence of the event, and that a lot of the long-standing emotions of pain and the real experience of loss will come much later.
And it seems things have happened very, very quickly. Obviously, the national and international press attention on this very small town is fairly unique. You don't see that with every situation of loss and grief. The fact that it is a small town, fairly isolated as well. I'm guessing that these are very specific issues that this town is going to be dealing with themselves.
Well, they're going to be dealing with the sensory overload with all the people, the celebrities, the world's attention. They're also going to be dealing with the fact that there were so many losses. And, you know, how do you grieve each person individually? And with respect to the town, how do you make room for both loss and a commitment to living and messages of both hope and healing?
And let's talk about those messages for a moment, because we've been talking about it here over the course of the morning during our breaks. And I've been wondering, what is the value of messages sent over social media in a moment like this? Because there's this need by those outside of Humboldt to let the people of Humboldt know that they are in our hearts, they are in our minds, they're in our hopes and our prayers. But I'm wondering, is there value in that at this point?
For the person sending the message, there is value in reacting to a situation of powerlessness and unpredictability by taking control and doing something. For the person receiving the message, I think that when we are hurting, the witnessing of our pain is a validation of that pain, and I think that's always helpful.
Karen, you said earlier that in a lot of cases you don't believe that the people in Humboldt are actually grieving at this point yet, that they're dealing with the onslaught of the media and dealing with this new normal that they're going to be dealing with. How long can the grief last? How long will this process take?
You know, I don't think there's a start point and an end point. I think your grief evolves with you, and certainly for the younger grievers, it will evolve with them through every life phase. It changes. It's not always front and center. The analogy I like is your grief becomes like a shadow. Depending on how the sun is shining, it's either in front of you, beside you, or behind you. It's either big and dark or just barely visible. And I think people go through their lives carrying the shadow of the losses, and there will be triggers that will make it loom larger. And then there will be times where people actually can get back to their lives.
Of course, there are survivors of this bus crash who have to deal with physical ailments, perhaps for their entire lives, and they have to deal, I'm guessing, with there might be issues of survivor's guilt as well. They're going to be very specific issues for them to deal with as well.
Absolutely, and they will be in a unique situation around navigating through their communities now.
What advice do you have for those of us on the outside who do want to support this community?
I think the most important thing that we can all recognize and participate in is the fact that it's counterintuitive. We always think the time of the death is the hardest and things get better. Actually, you're in a state of shock when the death occurs, and the multiple deaths are so overwhelming that you feel much worse before you feel better. So 3 to 6 months from now, I could assume that a lot of the emotional challenges that people will be experiencing will become full blown. I think we have to recognize that grief is as unique as your fingerprint, that we don't all grieve in the same way. And so not everybody will need to talk, but they will need to know that they can talk. So it's how can we support permission for people to grieve in the way that they need to and take as long as they need to, especially since so many of the losses involved males and their fellow teammates. And we sometimes don't give permission for males to grieve in the way that they need to. So there are some gender issues as well.
Well, there's going to be some real honest and hard conversations that are going to need to be had. And we thank you for walking us through a little bit of that this morning. Thank you so much.
Thank you.